Once again, here we are at Maria's Taco Xpress for AwesMic City. Whoa. Poetry and music. Whoa! Next up, Miss Anya Deshawn.
Yeah. You remember a little while ago I shared a story about the Russian lady. And so this is another section of this very long story. So it's a small section. What some of the children during the Holocaust saw and lived cannot compare to our sheltered life here. It cannot be imagined. We don't want to imagine it. And Olga and I, how did we chance to meet in Austin, Texas on our birthdays, face to face? She from Russia and us 30 years apart. Attending a political meeting I almost did not attend. Was it synchronicity? Or was it the encounter arranged so that we could pull the fragments together of our parallel lives from parallel universes to bring them into one layer where it can be pooled together enough to make a difference in the evolution of our souls, minds, and bodies? I can understand that together we pool our gifts and do as we were born to do, which is to assist in this advancement of humanity in any way we can. As I began to help her with her book that she was writing, where she was able to tell of a positive future in year 3000, it all made sense. And what she knew as a young child at 8 years of age, and to tell about events this planet would experience over a span of 1500 years. I was amazed to thumb through over 500 pages of information that spilled from her as a friend asked her questions and recorded them, then later transcribed them for this very important book. It is down in writing what she knew. It is down in writing what she knew 80 years ago. And who would believe an 8-year-old child who had a glimpse of the future enough to tell us of pending wars, peace, inventions, presidents, world leaders, and up to year 3000 on this planet and Mars. Who would believe her then as I believe her now? She is committed now in an asylum, as many are, who experience the spontaneous openings to the divine that no one can explain. Their reality is as real as the mountain people claim they have climbed with no witnesses. She believed in peace. Okay, this is about, I don't know if y'all have spell check on your email. I actually thought I sent an email one night and it didn't go through. And I woke up the next day and I thought, that's strange, they didn't write back. What's going on here? I go to the screen, pull it up, and it says, do you want to spell check that? Do you want to correct any error? You want to review for error? So I said, oh my God. And here I was calling on the phone. You haven't responded. You haven't responded. I haven't received anything yet, Anya. And so anyway, this is, and I was in a quirky mood. It's called Send Q. I am making a grand confession to you this instant and right now that my insignificant 2-line email I thought I sent you hit the misspell errors wall and how. But due to my trust in the system, and when I hit send, I thought it all the while followed through and reached you by instantaneous cyberspace shuttle to the very box marked in. I thought it was sent to you then, but alas, send it did not. So that dispels my thought process of the trusting email sending process thought. I then was forced to realize that misspelled corrections take priority, so much so that after I hit send, there'll be a pop-up window to pop up just for me. Because I chose for messages to be scrubbed before leaving said send bay, I'll need to heed said spelling error pop-up window, as it will pop up nonetheless to say that even no matter to what, to that, and to what not, yes, it will always add and append. Do you want to correct your spelling errors now or ignore and choose to send? No. And even if there are no actual misspells, to the possible misspells end, It will not send my email until I say yes to ignore and send. And override any misspells that are really not mine to any end. For it was the previous email with misspells included in my reply I received from a real live misspelling friend. It was not I. Alas, send I did this tiny email so modestly of only two lines, which sparred this longer poem to you I felt necessary to rhyme. And be as it may that the two-line email was sent so very late, it is with my sound of disgruntle you cannot hear out of said send queue is off to you this date. So have a nice whatever, if whatever serves you best, and I hope you enjoyed the modest two-line email that with a delay, a day delay, was sent. I'll be more patient with spell check, so I won't be a spelling bee wreck.
Okay, this is a good time to read this poem. I'll leave you to work out why. For historical reasons, it's called Que Pasa, but I just never got round to giving it a real title. I could make out that I sat glued to the monitor all night, waiting for the email to arrive. I could describe the moments of excitement as a quiet beep heralded the receipt of a new message, a missive, some exciting new communication, most of which are advertisements, which could have been your message, but was not. You could imagine the empty wailing sound as the bitstorms ravaged my computer, sweeping away precious settings as so Facebook was flooded with a million old farm town posts. I've unfriended Farmtown, disliked it, deactivated and banned it from posting on my wall, but like the rest of the Facebook and probably Twitch shop, it's ready for any opportunity to pounce, to spill an unending stream of pointless messages.
Yes, that's true.
Bitstorms can do that. We've all seen the photos of Jupiter taken up close and personal as Voyager flew past on its way to the rest of the universe. Impressive as the photos were, Voyager has not been faithful, photographing planets and moons as its fancy tugged it hither and yon, and for one memorable moment, it looked back and photographed the blue dot. I wonder if it formed something like a crystalline tear, as if it realized this might be the last time it would be able to see what it used to call home. But now, it is a citizen of, if not the universe, then at least the galaxy we call the Milky Way. In our naive or self-centered way, we forget that most galaxies must look like a milky streak across the night sky to its inhabitants. But each galaxy whirls away, an unending dance to the unending music of the spheres, each sun orbited by the detritus of its formation. Sometimes that includes a second sun. Sometimes a giant planet just too small to ignite. And maybe, on the sunward side of each gas giant, there will be a storm churning through eternity. A lowering red eye, forever pondering possibilities, wondering what it could have become. And sometimes, a tiny fragment of one of the small rocky planets will fly past, sending home snapshots of the early days of its everlasting vacation.
Wow. You got mail!
Oh yes, I see. You've got mail, that would be good. Okay, thank you. Can you face another one?
Oh yes, of course.
Okay, now everyone's written a parody of the Raven, haven't they?
Oh yeah, never.
Never more.
You will.
Well, this one is my attempt at, but I did it by memory, and I got the meter wrong. I left out half a line. Never mind. It's called Ill Met by Moonlight. Through a night that seemed eternal, plagued by processes infernal, through the mists of random snatches, memories that went before. Vibrant times of gallant sunshine, wine and meals and miles of coastline, shattered by a voice that echoed down the cursed corridor.
go to baggage counter 4.
Though the way was dark and dreary, and their limbs were getting weary, crowds set off. A ragged serpent dragged across the polished floor. Already somebody was wailing, will it ever be plain sailing to recover all the knick-knacks bought within that beachfront store? Where is baggage counter 4? Lifts were out, the walkways still, and the air was getting chill, but still the corps pressed on relentless in its quest for counter 4. Some swore, sweeping on like cattle. Soft beneath their footsteps rattle, bugles played a plaintive tune that ended on a minor chord. Counter 3, and nothing more. Moonlight filled the dingy halls, fell grey upon the shuttered walls where many a slice of pizza and McDonald's had been seen before. Someone asked a lone attendant in his uniform resplendent where to find this counter 4. He smiled and sent them down once more a corridor they'd seen before. And planes still leave from every gate, some on time and others late, while X-ray booths help capture evil terrorists with bombs in drawers. There's not just terrorists to fear. On quiet moments, you might hear footsteps cross the vacant patch of highly polished corridor, searching still for counter 4.
Philip, thank you. Okay, it's time again now for Neil Miley.
Smiley Miley.
So I don't know how, I can't follow that. That's beautiful and cosmic and all. But in the great mysteries of the universe, I was reading that the commissioner of the NFL made $44 million last year. I expect Tom can write this poem. He made $44 million. The cheerleaders are suing because they only make $5 an hour and don't have enough money to buy 2 yards material between 24 of them.
Okay, now,
here is
Pete Siebert.
Still basking in the glow of the 14th. Yeah. That evening was not only magical, as Elaine said, it was pure. Tom stood up and gathered us in, as he does in so many ways, with his words and his arms and his eyes. Looking at our liver, I found out tonight, he does pay attention. And my good brother last night said, take us to the promised land. Lord have mercy, what a task, what a job, what a call. But you know what I've been reflecting about today is, why is it that the gods dance and the saints laugh and play? I don't have the full answer to that. I'm still writing on it. It's still too fresh. It's still too fragrant to share, you know. It's still too green and mushy. It needs to come together. But I'll be sharing that. Reflect on that. Why do the gods dance and the saints celebrate and sing? Speaking of singing, one of the things we didn't do on Friday night, I had a little song sheet in there with some songs on it. We never had time. We had so much time, fun singing and emoting our poetry and those kinds of things. And I think tonight I'd like for you to sing with me a song. I think you know most of the words. Now when I'm on the train driving it with the kids, I give them a song that we can all sing along. I say, you know most of the words of this song, I bet you. A, B, C, D, E, F, G. But this is not that. But it's the ABCs of Texas. I want to change one word. Instead of the stars at night are big and bright, what's out there the last few nights? The moon at night is big and bright. Deep in the heart of Texas, the Cottage Trail, along the trail. Deep in the heart of Texas, the oil wells are full of smells. Deep in the heart of Texas, the sage in bloom is like perfume. Deep in the heart of Texas, Austin's weird and wears a beard. Deep in the heart of Texas, the ladies dance. I just want the ladies prance. I just want to dance. Deep in the heart of Texas, the coyotes wail along the trail. Deep in the heart of Texas, deep in the heart of Texas. One of the love poems that I didn't get to do because I had my few, Tom had his few, we shared the whole night. It made it much better than if one of us had got up there and spouted just like these open mics. Woman in all your forms and storms and all your sizes and shapes and ages. Baby, my baby girl. The little girl growing, young woman budding, young lady, girlfriend, fiance, new wife. Woman, whoa, wow, woo. My goddess with a little G leading me and growing with me to the God and goddess of all. And time, you, my dear, are the mother of our children. And then the cycle starts again. You told me, we're going to have a baby. It's a girl. Little girl growing, young woman budding, young lady. Another star shining that's on my mind, Stephanie, her name. She lit up my eyes and still does. She's here in Austin, the reason I'm here. She's 49 now, but I recall that first born morn that she was born September 21st, 1964. She's a joy often in my song, the daily path. That's what led me here, that little partner along the path. I stood with her as the father of the bride. I looked at her and said, no words have I. You've exceeded beyond my wildest dreams. The man of many words has no more to say in front of the lady who has come this way. I am now not the only man in her life. I'm now the father of the bride. Have I been promoted? Oh, no. Honey, dear, it is through you I learn that moderation in everything save love is the way to live. Oh, did the Creator make a mistake? Or is man and woman really from the Garden of Eden? And not from different planets, as the rumor is going round. Oh, is this a romantic view of woman? Oh, yes, in some ways. Obsessions can take over our hearts and our minds, but that romantic myth, planted in Eden's garden, rose again in the Renaissance. It haunts, it helps, it distracts, and guides us to that place called happily ever after. We learned it around the family hearth. We've seen it in the eyes of our fathers and mothers, big brothers and sisters. Too often it's been replaced by shows and plays and movies. Nah, that is a false viewpoint, is it not? But here's another viewpoint. He challenged all their perceptions of love and life and family. They believed it was the best of life in their youth. They believed the young woman was the best one. But too often they drank their wine just to reduce life miseries instead of to enhance as good medicine. Ah, he who turned the water into wine. And the people said, oh no, they've saved the best for last. We don't do it that way. We give away the best. And then you got to take the leftovers. He said, you give them the sweet taste of the juice. It tastes like a honeymoon. You put it in the bottle called marriage, in the bottle called commitment. Paper sign, okay, not necessarily. But you know what happens in that bottle? The juice ferments, and some days you wake up, it doesn't taste so sweet. Some days it boils and bubbles and will blow the damn cork right out the top. Then it begins to settle in that old oak barrel. And you taste it. And it's improved. It's a year older. And like good wine, the longer it goes. And finally, the best comes last. The woman really wears white. Why is it in our society we color up and we hide the white?
There's an old Hasidic saying that to the unloved and to the unlearned, old age is winter. But to the unloved, but to the loved and to the learned, old age is harvest. It is harvest. And he who said the best things in life come last, after your body and your mind and your heart are yielded to God and to each other, to those we meet and those who carry our blood, those who wave our flag, yes, even those who we mistakenly call our enemies, because they and we have forgotten our understanding of good and what is best, even in our own revelations, limited though they may be, we can live up to our commitments. We can have the champagne. We can dream with Isaiah. There is the day coming when the lion and the lamb will lie down together. And as Godspell said it so well, we can build a beautiful city. Oh, yes, we can. Oh, yes, we can.
Spring-like scene is called Austin Pulse. Ponytails swing down the hike and bike. Dogtails wag from tethered pups. Guitars twang from shaded coves. All things beat to an Austin Pulse. Even now, despite traffic snarls, in spite of rampant growth, notwithstanding villains of change, the old Waterloo soul remains in the city of the Violet Crown. I have tagged along for life half the 20th and more. I've seen much come and go, but the heartbeat of the town I still feel, still detect, still hold. Thank you. And now for a differing opinion, Tom the World Poet.
I have to respond to Anya. Anya told me in Brazil, 18 children were murdered, the indigo children, you know, the hope of our future. And on Facebook, which I trust, there was a news about a young girl who was stoned to death in Syria for going onto Facebook. Okay. So this is called silent wards, locked wards. If you are screaming, we have sedation. So strong, you will zombie drool. If you are violent, lobotomies, with your controlling mechanisms removed. If you are holy, blessed by voices, we can silence them too. We are the removalists. Memory is our enemy. Abuse, your childhood, poor love, worst sex? No problem. We move in, these cockroaches move out. We have bugs to destroy all superbugs. Homeopathy applied to toxicities. Poison memories excised with a single sensory sensor. Content moderated. Phone calls monitored. Security systems installed. And you pay for the bullets, bombs, defense budgets. Your only enemy is memories of something else. Peace, small child. The children do not know, and they will not be told. We have guns and tasers in your schools. So here's a happier one.
God!
I'm just feeling just sinking into the ground. It can't go on like this. It can't. Okay. Let's go. Okay, here's a way out. Habitually speaking, I pray you understand how meditation and contemplation changes every woo man, and how prayers, chants, and hymns change consciousness, especially when employed at the very core of us. Reassuring each church choir as in a tribal way, you sway to the rhythms inherent in the play of sounds and music combined today to reaffirm beliefs in which you wish to stay. Different lyrics might produce a Beyonce, a Madonna clone or Lady Gaga play, Britney Spears or some rock goddess long since passé. In this, words have power and song has liberation, combined for sacredness in special situations. When we combine our voices tonight, our choices multiply tonight. Harmonies are power ours, watch those grace notes fly. For she believed in Reiki, learned and practiced Reiki. This led to interesting excursions in healing herself and others. She trusted in oneness. She trusted in connection. Her world was around, above, below, before, after, and within. She decided to trust more in this unfolding, that each day's footprint would present itself, that each and every moment was its own unique event. All that's ever happened, inbuilt into what really is, and she had embarked upon a steep learning curve. She became familiar with serendipities, epiphanies, miracles, which would manifest when she least expected. She became curious about past lives, spiritual mysteries. Her world was now a world of wonder, curiosity, and adventure. When she woke up, she decided to go back to the dreaming. Lucky we are to be here tonight, to breathe tonight, to have gifted faculties which allow us to express tonight. Gratitude in a world divided by privilege. We are by chance in that top 1% of those with water, food, and fuel sufficient to meet our daily needs. By chance we are here and others are not, or not yet. Prior to our occupation, indigenous cultures lived a very different lifestyle. Our ancestors killed theirs. Remington House haunted by such slaughters, reservations, casinos, extinction. Even for us, time is a gift. It must be returned along with this borrowed skin suit, these deeds, this karma. What a privilege it is to be here now.